More now on those fears. Anti-vax protests in Melbourne could turn into a super-spreading event with a demonstrator hospitalised with COVID-19.
Let's bring in infectious diseases expert Professor Robert Boy, who joins us now from Medlow Bath in New South Wales. Nice to see you this morning. I mean, all of us, we saw those protests. There were thousands of people there. How do you think this one plays out, Robert?
Well, unlike many others, this certainly could be a super-spreader event. Crowding, running, shouting, many without masks, most unvaccinated. There's all the ingredients, apart from the fact they've got the ventilation of being outside, but all the other ingredients of a real problem and a spreading event.
OK, Victoria recorded its highest ever daily case numbers yesterday, 766 new infections. With your modelling and with your expertise, what do you see it going to over the next few weeks?
Well, it's a worry. It's not in control. And it's a real lesson to everyone else, not to criticise, but to say this Delta can get out of control. So just because things are great in Queensland and WA, it doesn't mean that one limousine driver or one truck driver can cause trouble. I can see this going to 1,000. And just as New South Wales did, peaking out at a large-ish number and then falling again. Mm. They're doing their very best. They can do probably a little bit better, but, you know, that go hard, go early approach hasn't worked because Delta is such a foe.
So, I mean, that's a very good point that you raise. What more could Melbourne and Victoria have done?
Yeah, well, there's, you know, better lockdowns, and the age-old problem is compliance. There's people playing by the rules, and if 99% do, there's still tens of thousands who don't. And so we need to police a little bit better. I'm not into rings of steel, but I am into police and community people monitoring each other's behaviour.
Let's talk about the positives, and there are plenty, because the vaccination rates are going really well. I mean, October 11, New South Wales looks like Freedom Day. Things are starting to open up. That's good news and reward for a job well done, isn't it?
Well, it won't be Freedom Day. There'll be a whole bunch of things that we need to maintain and keep going, and then we keep control. So testing and tracing and the occasional isolation for the sick person, social distancing and masks, but we'll be able to go to shops and cinemas. Yeah. We'll have the passport. Mm. It really will be great. I totally agree.
So what do you think the difference is going to be between hitting that 70% mark and then what additional freedoms might people in New South Wales see once the state hits 80%, which will only be a couple of weeks behind?
Yeah, I think it could be as little as 7 to 10 days. So
wow.
The opening up will be relatively rapid, with first doses already above 80% in many parts of New South Wales. That second dose will follow through 3 to 6 weeks later. So those second doses will really ramp in, because once you've got almost everyone first dose, everything goes into the second doses. So the rapidity and the speed can go up, especially if people take their second dose at 3 to 4 weeks, we'll be getting there much faster. What will we get? Well, we'll get just more freedoms. We'll have more access to the things we want to do. We'll start to have overseas travel, passports into the outback, which many people are hoping to do first before they do any overseas travel. So there'll be a lot of privileges that will follow on from being double vaccinated.
Given what you've said about the virus and we know about the virus now, when Queensland Premier Anastasia Palaszczuk says, I'm not even sure about 80%. Is she right to be that cautious?
Well, you're not going to get herd immunity, so she's right in that sense. She's right in having controlled her state's issues and incidents and numbers. Look, at some point, you've got to make a decision. You can get the numbers of outbreaks smaller, shorter, fewer in number, but you can't totally eliminate, especially in a large, crowded state. And Queensland has been fortunate as well as clever. And so at some point, they've got to open up. And if they open up early, they're worried that they'll get an outbreak. We're looking right now at the UK. And the UK has opened up over the last couple of months. And now schools are back as well. And there's a lot of cases. But I've checked with the intensive care doctors in London and the paediatric doctors, they're not seeing a huge surge in kids having COVID. So that's reassuring. So opening up maybe just to have a small kind of flu-like outbreak where most people have a relatively mild disease.
Mm. Problem is that there isn't an appetite for that, for letting it in Queensland.
Yeah, it's politics and it's public health, and the two have to somehow compromise and work with each other. And the public health will win out when people start to realise that if you don't open up, you won't have livelihoods to go back to.
Well, they're not letting it in, and it's a very popular move from her, as we saw yesterday. And Queenslanders, they're holding on as long as they can. Good to talk to you, Professor. Have a great weekend. Enjoy the grand final. Anti-vax protesters, meantime, have stooped to new lows, abusing medical staff administering COVID jabs. This is appalling behaviour. A nurse was even spat on. What's your response?
It's been a disgrace. Their behaviour is disgusting. They are rioters. They're not protesters. They don't have a cause other than their own self-interest. And their treatment, particularly of health staff this week, has been disgusting. It's not something we should tolerate.
Yeah.
And I've been here at Town Hall. I've felt the fear and the angst of the staff. And it's just not something we can tolerate, Carl.
Yeah, and incidentally, one of those protesters, we learn, has tested positive to COVID-19. And this now has the ability to spiral, right?
It certainly does. And I think everybody needs to understand you can't opt out of the virus. And one of these rioters getting the virus, I think, really brings that home. And it also means you can't opt out of vaccination. It's something that's absolutely key. But can I just say, Carl, on Wednesday when we had the worst of the behaviours, 400 people at the Shrine, a very sacred place, there were also 92,500 people that got vaccinated that day.
Hear, hear.
And it just shows the majority of people are focused on the main game.
You know, and it shows how resilient Melbourne people are. It shows how stoic they are and how much they want to get on with it, right? Yeah. And they want their freedoms. What is that feeling like now?
Well, look, in between earthquakes and riots this week, it's been really hard. I think there's a lot of emotion this week and people are pretty depleted. We want to get excited about the grand final. It's not here in Melbourne, but there are two Melbourne teams and we've got a lot to be proud of. We called for the roadmap. We've got a roadmap. Let's really focus on those steps forward and those steps out of lockdown.
OK, so who wins the grand final? You've got to lay it on the line now, Mayor. You've got to pick a side and stick with it. Let's go. Who is it going to be?
Yeah, it's got to be the D's.
Yeah.
Go D's. We've been singing the song. They're in our municipality. I love the Bulldogs, of course, and there are plenty of Bulldog supporters. And we're so pleased that Melbourne's going to be brilliantly represented in Perth on Saturday. I hope it's a really close game, but we're really hoping that Melbourne wins the AFL Grand Final and that Melbourne Storm wins the NRL Grand Final.
OK, we'll take that, handsome Hemsworth boys. From the Lord Mayor of Melbourne. Good on you, Sally. Thank you for being with us. Have a great weekend.